Testing, testing. Let's go. Here we go. The Mic Is Yours is a platform for local artists, artists around the world, to get on the platform and do your thing. From singing, dancing, comedy, poetry, spoken word, we want it all. And we want to show the world that the mic is yours.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are coming back to the Mic Is Yours with another mic check. It's your DJ, Mark Lane Entertain. We got on the show on today, Miss Visionary Speaks. How you doing, Visionary Speaks? Talk to us. What's going on with you?
All right, everybody. How you doing?
All is well your way. Where you coming to us from?
Well, I'm coming to you from Detroit. You know, we straight out 313, baby. You know, what up, though?
In the house, that's what's up. So you from Detroit? That's originally where you from?
Born and raised. You know, people haven't come to Detroit to, you know, just be here since Motown days. So when you from Detroit, you are from Detroit.
Motor City, right?
Motor City. Yeah, we had two eras that people forget about. They remember the slums, but they don't remember that we created jobs in Motor City. We created jobs in Motown.
Right.
We had our good moments, and people forget that. So I like to remind them that, yeah, you needed us. And through the election, again, you needed us.
Tell us just a little bit about, you know, your journey. I know you do comedy, and in reference to, you know, how you kind of got into what you do and what you do and do what you do, you know.
You know what I do. So I'm a comedian. I actually am a quarantine comedian. I started during the quarantine.
Yes, ma'am.
People are so surprised to hear that because it was just kind of a natural thing. People who know me were surprised that I took that shift. But people who, you know, like just outwardly know me, they know I'm silly. If you know me, you know I'm silly. But just to go from, you know, having a master's degree, having a good job, good state job, and I still do. I haven't made that transition completely. You know, we ain't walking out with the door being fully closed. But, I made that transition to doing comedy because I honestly had an audible conversation with God. And I told him, I said, look, I need to know what you want me to do with all this talent, honey. Because I can't just live like this.
Yeah.
I need to know. Yeah. And I've always been a creative spirit. So when I was younger, I danced. I wrote songs. I'm a singer as well. I was just all over creative. I did a little acting spiel in my life. So there's always been an element of creativity. And then you get grown. And they tell you got to do the real life stuff. And you kind of move away from all that. I actually even went to Atlanta for a year in my junior year of college. I left my school at Western, big up to the Broncos, for a year. And I said, I'm gonna chase my dreams and I'm gonna become a singer and I'm gonna move to Atlanta. So I did that. Didn't go exactly how I thought it would, but you're so shocker, you guys. Spoiler alert, I'm not famous. But it gave me a lot of life lessons. I learned a lot about myself and growth and living on my own and doing my own thing. And I had a whole new experience. That was the first time I lived out of state. So everything happens for a reason. So flash forward to now. Now I'm in my regular life. I'm married, you know, I got married.
Yes, ma'am, got the kiddo.
Thank you. But married to my love, my life, over 10 years. We were together for 10 years before we got engaged.
Okay.
So I think we actually got married on the 10th year of being together. It was 10-19-19.
All right.
So, I mean, hey, we made it. But it got too regular for me, and I'm not the type of person who can live that regular life. I'm just not meant for it. And I just found myself having too many moments of sadness, not being my full self.
Come on now. Yes, ma'am. So you blessed us. You testify.
I mean, I'm just trying to tell you my journey, my story. I mean, it might be yours, but, you know, it happens. I think when you're not walking in your purpose.
Yes, ma'am.
You feel it. And especially when you're destined for something great. And I always knew that something was in me to either teach to people, be a visionary, talk to people, give them, be a voice of what we're experiencing. I just didn't know the vessel. I didn't know how I was going to do it. And I also didn't know how I was going to be financially stable while I did it.
Now, what's your name? It's Visionary Speaks or something like that, right?
Yes.
So tell me, when you say visionary, break that down for me. What's going on with that right there?
So, a visionary in itself, and it's funny you say that because I remember 2 years before I even thought about comedy or anything, I was in a bathroom and I was looking in the mirror and I said to my husband, I was like, I'm a visionary.
Come on,
and
now.
He said, what does that even mean? I'm like, well, I feel like I'm supposed to influence a large group of people. I'm supposed to be a voice of the people. I'm supposed to start some kind of a movement.
Right.
And I feel like God put me on this earth to lead. And he was like, what kind of example, what are you trying? I was like Martin Luther King was a visionary.
Right.
And he stopped and he said, did you just compare yourself to Martin Luther the King? And I said, you are absolutely right, I did. Because I think people forget that we have our celebrities and we have people who lead and people who've gone down in history for doing something great. They forget that before you knew them, they were just a regular person. Obama was just Barack. He grew up in Hawaii and Chicago and all this other. He was just a regular guy. You would have passed him on the street, wouldn't even know him. And all of these people become that after.
Right.
So I always wonder when people downplay people and say, oh, you think you like them? You think you like, I'm like, who am I not to?
Come on now.
What makes them any different than me? I could be going down the same path. Oprah didn't get her first opportunity until she was after 30, I think.
There you go. Yes, ma'am.
So it's like, why wouldn't I be that? And if something is in me telling me that I am that, who are you to tell me that I'm not?
Ooh, watch out now. Yes, ma'am.
I mean, hey, I ain't preaching, but I'm just saying. I believe in what God put in me. And that's where the visionary came from. Because visionaries are just people who have a unique outlook for the future.
All right.
The ability to lead. If you look at what a visionary is, it's just someone with a unique outlook of the future and creativity to make a change, a positive change on the outlook. So I thought visionary and then visionary speech just kind of came together.
I like
in that way. I don't know. It came to me one day. It was literally the day after I charged up God. And I said, look, Lord, I need to know what you want for me. I need to know. And how do I use this? Because I'm a counselor by trade. I have a master's degree in counseling.
Okay, that's what's
up. Hey, I'm just working on mentals. And I was doing that, and I still am doing that. But I knew that was just a part of who I am. I'm really intuitive to people. I love helping people. I can really read into what people are dealing with. Some people call it an empath. I just call it that divine intervention, that voice.
So you combining a little bit of your personality and your comedy into...
Yes.
I like that.
Yes. I can use me fully, because I knew it's things that so many things I could have done, And I never thought about comedy as an option, but that's what I tell you. When I had that conversation, he responded. I implore you all, have audible conversations. I'm just walking around my house just talking. Like, just God, I know what you did when you did what you did when you birthed me. You put something in me and I can't get it out. And I said, Lord, if it ain't for me, take it out. Take it off my spirit. I can't live like this. I can't live with this in my heart and my soul. And it's not for me. It's making me sad. I'm going down a spiral, Jesus. And I need you to tell me what to do with this. And if I'm not going to do anything with it, just take it away.
No, that's why I was going to ask you real quick before I give you the mic. Who was one of your influences, inspirations in reference to comedy? Who's one of your best comics?
So the actual inspiration to, one of the inspirations to me becoming a comic, and mind you, I'm a Def Jam comedy kid, okay? And people be like, how can you be a Def Jam comedy kid? You wasn't around when those things was coming, when they were live.
Right.
I'm like, well, my dad bought the DVDs.
Okay.
He bought the DVDs. So after school, I would run home with my best friend and we would just watch Def comedy jam DVDs.
That was the lit.
He could quote Chris Tucker's, you know, I'm pissed off, man. I could quote that verbatim. Like, every single scene. It was so many good ones that I, you know, I would watch Bernie Mac, Martin Lawrence, all these people. But the person who really gave me the shit and told me I can do everything that I want to do within my politics, my hilarity, my actual wanting to do positive change.
Right.
And that was Dave Chappelle. And after 8:46, now I've always been a follower of Chappelle. He's always been one of my favorite comics. But something around the time that he came back and did 8:46. Have you seen it? It was his special.
I'm gonna have to check it out.
Oh my God. Crazy bit. Like, it literally changed the tides for things. Like, his special. So he dropped the special during quarantine. Mm. And it was in his backyard. And what he did was he talked about the George Floyd murder. And he talked about so many other things that's going on. And he actually took a couple of shots. There was a few shots. But one of them was, I guess, the one that made him do the special, which was Don Lemon saying, "Where are you, celebrities? Where is your voice? You know, and all of this. Why aren't you speaking up and playing your part?" And it's funny because it's ironic. His response to Don Lemon is that the people can speak for themselves. They don't need me, you know, to come out. You know, this is not a "Where's Ja" moment, if you know that reference. Right. Where's Ja during Hurricane Katrina? Like, nobody cares what Ja Rule has to say at this point. But he said that, and he couldn't have known this, but it was farthest from the truth.
Right.
Because at that point, he's humbling, of course. He's humbling himself to say, I'm not that important to people that I need to be the one that hear during hard times. But laughter is what you need during hard times.
Yeah.
And comics, if you notice, have always been the voice of the disenfranchised people. You know, they would speak and say things that, you know, weren't always PC, but they said what was on their heart. And usually they were speaking to the people who were at the bottom or had experienced those things.
Ooh.
So him doing that, he said everything that we wanted to say. And he didn't even know that he did that. He didn't even know how important that was to have a moment of all this crazy stuff going on, a moment of laughter.
A moment
to just be happy.
You know, and it's funny you said it. I hear that about a lot of comics, is that you would be surprised in a lot of times what they're dealing with in life. And actually, they will use comedy to comfort themselves,
yes.
You know, but in actuality, they're really dealing with some things, but it's the comedy within them that allows them to laugh about what they're going through. And they and it's real life, but then they make another's laugh and they're laughing at themselves. But you know, I was talking to a buddy of mine, but you're right. I mean, I feel like laughter is something that we definitely got to keep, especially in this day and time that we're living in. You know, we got to keep some laughing going. But, you know, so what I was going to do is I was going to go ahead and give you the mic and let you give us a little something.
Yes.
The mic is yours. Do your thing.
Awesome. So, you know, in the transition of all transitions, right to the comedy. But like I said, I'm Visionary Speaks. And I just have to say, you know, I don't know what's going on. You know, I think that the reason why laughter is needed so much right now is because it's so much crazy stuff going on. How can you not take advantage of everything that Donald Trump said? Like, this is just essential. I mean, he never says anything that's not comedy gold. I mean, this man has presented every funny joke possible. He's giving you free content on the daily, baby. How could you not? You know, how could you not take advantage of this? And that's a part of the reason why I became a comic. You know, along with the fact that, you know, it's just too much going on to not be funny.
Come on now.
I mean, I just had seen and experienced. I'll tell you something. Listen, there was it's funny moments in the chaos. Let me just tell you that it's some hilarity in the chaos. So a situation happened here in Detroit, right? Had a shooting of a young black male here in Detroit. I'm sure y'all haven't heard about it, and I'll tell you why. There was a shooting, and it's 3:00 in the afternoon. I'm watching TV. And my husband comes up to me and they're like, look, man, somebody, they said it was a shooting, so everybody's all riled up. Mind you, it's 3 o'clock in the afternoon, okay? I turn on my TV, I just found out there's a possibility that something happened. Why is every white person, every hood person, together at arms already on 6 Mile? Like, look, it happened on 6 Mile at 2:45. These people got signs. These people got bullhorns. These people are there at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. How?
Something ain't right.
How? I don't even think that works out in the terms of the driving distance. I don't know if they getting a head notice that somebody getting shot at 2:45, so they'll be there at 3. Either way,
right.
These people was on the block. One, I was offended.
Uh-oh.
Because I've been doing my protesting and all my political posts and everything. I feel like I'm a part of the movement. Why didn't I get a call?
Who is
sending out the mass email that forgot me but added the white people from Rosedale and the white people from Rochester and all the West Bloomfield people? They all on the block. They on 6 Mile. They ain't never seen 6 Mile in their life. Okay?
Right.
But there it is. Who sent out the Facebook post? Either way, aside from me being heavily offended, you know, but apparently my black life didn't matter when it came to email posts. But that's fine. So they're all on there. The news is following them. Because, you know, the news, they like, their antennas went off. They're like, people are protesting. Time to catch them live. Make sure you get the most ignorant black people to talk first. You know, all of that. And so I'm watching it. But they're saying on the news that our black police chief is going to come out and make a statement at 7 o'clock because he has video evidence that there was some potential misgivings of information. Okay? So here's me waiting at home with my drink, just watching the news, watching them go out. I saw somebody with one of them long banners, and I'm like, who is working the printing press? Because this is a lot. Okay? They made this very quickly. Like, y'all are literally out here with banners, Black Lives Matter. Y'all out here on the block, baby. Okay? They were on a lodge with them. And I'm like, hey, how did we do this so quickly? Two, do we know all the facts?
Right.
So I'm ignorant. So I'm just on my phone videotaping the news. Like, why are y'all out here and y'all don't know what happened? I mean, y'all could really be out here for some shenanigans, but you out here either way, because, you know, black lives do matter. But if this turns out to be some misinformation and that he did something that justified this, y'all gonna look like some boo. Okay?
Right.
So I'll wait till 7 o'clock like all the other good people who wanted to know the truth. So our police chief comes out. And he's just saying, you know, we know that there has been some uprisings in the streets and everybody's upset and everybody's protesting, but we just have to get all the facts before we start to get here out on the block. And I do have the facts, so I will show them to you now. So I'm just sitting at home with my drink like, let's see how this happens. And he plays the video. Multiple times. So he comes, here is the assailant. We actually went to the scene of the crime because there was an actual call in that there was some people who had committed a drive-by shooting the weekend before, and they were found walking down the street, and we thought that they were one of the suspects in the shooting. So we pull up, here's us arresting them. You know, we put them as handcuffs, and here is when the young man got up. He's actively running away, and here is the gun right here. He pulls out the gun. There it is. Zoom in there. Right there. There's the gun. He takes 2 shots at the police. That's the one shot right there. Just go back a little bit more. That's the one shot, and here comes, wait, there it is, the second shot, and at that point, our brave police officers shot this young man down as he was about to lay off the third shot. And there he is. There he goes. And if we can go back and play that again in slow motion. I was like, oh my God. I was like, oh, oh. here it is. Here it is, you know, the facts. And although we don't want any of our young men, our young kings to die in this way, it just, the situation itself gave me just a little bit of joy. Not because he passed away, but because the ignorance of this so uprighteous movement of people these days, we'll jump up for anything.
That's right.
You tell us that an injustice has happened, we are on the lodge, baby. We are already there. Okay, we're not looking for facts. We're not looking for the information.
Get the facts.
And it's like we are already out there. And I'm like thinking in my head, who's gonna be the one to tell them? Because they still out there. They not watching the news, baby. They on the streets. They still got their sign. No justice, no peace. I'm like, who's gonna tell them that it was a justified shooting? And then my comedy mind started thinking, what if it was me? What if I did get that email to join? Because I'm all about the movement.
Oh, yeah.
And how mad would I be when I found out that it was a justified shooting? I could just see myself now. You know, just, you know, no justice, no peace. No justice, no peace. Sister, no justice, no peace. Sister, no justice. What's going on, boy? Well, he had a gun. He was shooting at police. Oh, heck, you know. No, wait a minute. Who organized this? Put it on the map. Where's my boo horn? Hello? Who organized this? Because I need to know right now. Because somebody's taking me back to my car. I done walked 2 blocks for y'all. 2 blocks. And who do I send the invoice for the gas?
Right.
Somebody's paying for my gas. Right. No justice, no peace. Somebody go give me a piece, because I done walked 2 blocks for y'all for some foolishness. You should have watched the news. I just knew I'd be pissed. I knew. I knew that I would have a moment in time where it would because I do it for the right reasons. And, you know, it's already a risk to leave your house. You know? I'd be mad. Like, you got me out here, just out here in the fray with the community. I had to have my husband watch my dog.
Right.
And y'all gonna tell me it was for nothing? Somebody is gonna pay for my gas. So, those are the type of things that happen. And you know, and this is just such a sensitive time.
True.
Everybody's so sensitive. And I'm not saying that we haven't been long overdue to pay attention to people's cries.
Of course.
That's not the case.
That's right.
Some of y'all cries. It's for spoiled men. Like, y'all will cry for any and everything, okay? Not everybody's cries should be heard. Now, the big cries, you know, getting the rights and everything, Black people's lives matter, those are the cries. But every little cry, y'all cry over everything that somebody said. They cried over what people said on, what Dave Chappelle said on SNL, crying, mate. You know, it is just so many things that trigger people. They just trigger. And now y'all are minimizing the big triggers.
I heard that. Okay.
There are some real grenades out here. If we crying over everything that somebody said and they shouldn't say that. Oh my God. And what about my things? What about all lives matter and everything? It's just, and y'all crying over unnecessary stuff, okay? You're making a big thing seem small. You created this fake news with all your tears. Okay? Like, I'm sick of it. Everybody, if you don't like what somebody said back in the day, you know what we could do? Walk away.
Uh-oh, watch out now. Walk away, yes ma'am.
How easy is that? You don't like what you're watching? You know what you could have did? Turn the channel. Even back in the day, they got their big butts up and they went and they turned it off. Okay? They ain't like it, they turned it off. All you gotta do is press a button.
That's it.
Why do you have to make it a big deal every time somebody says something you don't like?
All right.
We're too sensitive. We're too sensitive. We don't allow comics to be comics. You know, comedian, no matter what a comic says, they can say something that's just off the wall, terrible. You know, and if it's really funny, we don't laugh. I mean, and that's just the honesty of it. If you say something that's funny, genuinely funny, even, and that's the line you teeter. You know, I watch Family Guy all the time. They say some stuff that I'd be like, ooh, that was racist. I felt it in my spirit. God, that was racist. But it was funny. It was so funny. Because in the midst of all the craziness, in the midst of everything that could hurt our either feelings, if you say it in a clever way, sometimes we gotta laugh at ourselves.
That's
we
right.
We are funny. Black people, Chinese people, white people, we all are funny in our cultural ways.
Yeah.
Sometimes you can laugh at yourself, and it's not, but once you get the laugh, it's not a personal attack.
Mm.
No, but people forget, and some people who try to do that just don't know that they're not really funny. They don't know there's a difference. You can make a political joke, a racial joke, you can make all these types of jokes, but you gotta be funny. Because if you're funny, people are roll with you. Like Dave Chappelle has said some off the wall stuff,
right?
But he was super funny. You know, he made a whole rape joke about Bill Cosby raping what he said. He saved so many people, but he got a rape along the way. That should not work. Period. It should not fly. It should make no sense. But the way that it's a creative art.
Right.
So we have to allow art to be art and let it be timeless and receive it. The things that Richard Pryor said wasn't always right. You know? Things that all these people said back in the day, all the visionaries.
Come on.
They weren't always right. Yes. And they weren't always PC. They said how they felt and they left it on the table. Mm. And you can take it or you can leave it. And that's the kind of legacy.
Come on.
Those are the people that I want to be reckoned with. Because I don't want to just be editing myself for you. I'm editing myself for the people who get it. You know, if you don't get it, then I don't have to really say anything, because if you never got it, you won't get it. So I feel like this stage of comedy, one, is necessary.
All right.
It's necessary, people. We locked in our home. Who would have thought? You know, new year, new me. I bet you ain't think this. You know, when you was making that January, folks, we all did it. We was all hype at the January 2020, you know, 2020 vision, all that. Y'all was happy at 12 o'clock January 1st.
And you had the vision. The visionary had the vision.
I had the vision. I mean, well, no, I didn't, because if I did have the vision, I would have been like, ooh, girl, just know. There's some things I need to tell you about what's about to happen this year. All that new year, new me stuff is gone. You're going to have to go back to just buy yourself new year by myself, or new year, new toilet paper. You know, or new year, new drinks. You know, because I've made so many new drinks during this time. I've experimented a lot with my drink choice. New year, new books that you said you was going to read that you never did. New year, new TV shows. I watched a new season of shows that's been on for years. I think I watched 30 Rock. 30 Rock. Never seen 30 Rock a day in my life. And I said, you know what? I got time today. And I watched literally every season of that show. I didn't even know when it was over. I was like, did I literally watch 17 seasons of this show? Yes, I did. I had
time. Vision every season. Y'all give it up. Hey, where can folks find you?
Yes, you can find me on all the platforms, okay?
Okay.
And just before you get there, know that this is a starting from the bottom situation. So I need all of y'all to follow me, because I'm building for my babies, like a little cheek egg. And you may not see too many people in there, but it just takes one person to know somebody, okay? We're trying to move it up, because I want y'all to get on board before it's hundreds and thousands of people in there.
There you go. All right.
Come on, early adopters. Y'all are my co-visionaries. So you can find me at Comedian Visionary Speaks on all the platforms, the Facebook, the Instagram, the YouTube. I have a podcast called 2020 Vision Podcast. Baby, you need to get on that.
All right.
Because
y'all heard it.
It's a blessing. Okay. It is a blessing. We tackle topics that's not all funny. I've tackled one of my topics was the black on black crime fallacy, because we need to break that down. That is a fallacy, and a fallacy means an untruth.
Mm.
Black on black crime is not a thing. And it's not to say that black people don't kill Black people. That happens. But to label us as the ones who's doing it, like crime isn't happening everywhere to every race, is the fallacy. Okay? They don't say white on white crime. They don't say Asian on Asian crime. And that's where they coined that in the Nixon era, just to be for Black people. I also talked about the election. I did the Black vote in the Biden-Harris campaign. We've talked about relationship status. Do we really need titles anymore? Like, what is a title in a relationship? Is that just something to make sure that you ain't stepping out on somebody, which doesn't make you not step out on somebody? So we talk about that, the titles that bind us. So go ahead, watch some of my old episodes. I filmed that. Usually I try to go every Thursday at 7 o'clock. I try is a very real word. But I'm trying to get my consistency up with that. But yes, 2020 Vision Podcast. I've just been moving and shaking. I actually filmed a special. I'm staying on top of my videographer because I filmed that special back in August, honey, and I still ain't got the footage. Okay? Try to support Black business. How? Okay? But, I filmed my own special.
Right.
It's an hour special from my backyard. I did it on my 30th birthday back in August.
Okay.
And that special is called I Just Have to Say. Because that's my tagline. I'm Comedian Visionary Speaks, and I just have to say. Because it's too much that needs to be said. So I just have to say it. If you're not going to say it, I have to say it. Okay. One last plug is, I can't, just by the length of this video, but this is my, I Am the Fear.
Okay.
I Am the Fear is my movement. And I Am the Fear is that I am the fear that one day I will recognize my worth. Because the one thing that we don't know is how much we are worth and how much we bring, especially minorities, what we bring to the table.
All right.
We bring so much to the table. And the fear of the ones above us who have brought us down so much and has profited off of us and used us all these years, the fear is that one day we would realize how much we were worth.
All right now. All
if right. we did, then we would demand more and we wouldn't settle. So that's what the I Am the Fear movement is about, realizing your true worth and not settling for whatever people are willing to give you.
Don't settle. Yes, ma'am.
Don't settle. Oh, I got shirts that say don't settle. Okay, oh. Once I get my website, baby, it's going to be shirts galore, honey. Shirts galore. Because I have so many, not even catchphrases, but just mantras for life. You know, I am the fear, don't settle. All these mantras that just implore you to be your best self and allow whatever God has for you to be present in your life instead of dealing with whatever comes your way. You know, taking control.
Like it's yours.